and gentlemen, welcome to Leadership in Politics with Dr. Abraham. With me today is an award-winning author, Leo Bottary, who is going to talk about peer innovation. Thank you for sending this book. And thank you for, you have signed this book for me. So I kind of cherish every book that is signed. Is going to go into, here you go. So thank you for this book. I appreciate it. As you know, I read most of the books that are sent to me, glance at them. But this book in particular, it was of interest to me. If I tell you I enjoyed it, it's an understatement. I loved it. Reason, because it resonated with me as a professor. As you know, I teach leading teams and individuals, organizational behavior and organization theory. What you have here, you have created a model, a factor model, where any reader can go to it, read it, understand the process, and they, in a way, build the team of their choosing. Before I ask you about the premise of the book, I'm going to go further and ask you about the factors. You can talk about the five factors as we go further. What is the premise of the book? Tell us. Welcome again.
Oh, thank you. The premise of the book is basically, I've spent a lot of time studying CEO peer advisory groups and peer advisory groups. And it became evident really quickly from that work that what peer advisory groups do so brilliantly can be applied to high-performing teams. Okay. So one of the, as you speak to the five factors, they speak to having the right people, you know, in the group. They speak to psychological safety, not only that this the environment of psychological safety exists, but the people actually leverage it and access it, that they are doing everything they can to be productive, that they are accountable to one another in a way that's not onerous upon them. It's a way where they actually accept personal responsibility for bringing their best to each and every meeting and each and every engagement. And then, of course, looking at the leadership front, as leaders of groups, and I believe teams as well, are well served when they have a leader who is truly there to support the success of the team rather than have the team be supporting their individual success, right? So that's really where this came from. I've done over now 200 workshops with CEO peer advisory groups, certainly done a lot of work with cross-functional work teams and organizational work teams, you know, in different companies. And this has been pressure tested in many ways by this point. And I just look forward to bringing this work, and again, bringing what peer advisory groups do so well into more and more companies.
The five factors, you also have productivity and you also have accountability. So right people, psychological safety, leadership, productivity, and accountability. That's your own model?
And they form a reinforcing loop. Originally, we had five factors that were named slightly differently in The Power of Peers, which was a book that I co-authored with Leon Shapiro back in 2016. Since that time, it became evident that not only was it appropriate to change the name slightly of each of the five factors, but recognize that they do really form that reinforcing loop. You know, you and I, before the show, were talking about systems thinking, right? Yeah, and we recognize the power of reinforcing loops. And I think it was very evident that starting with the right people, unlocking the potential of those right people with psychological safety so they can be more productive. And when they have that level of productivity and psychological safety, they have the freedom to challenge one another to be better, which allows them to create a very healthy culture of accountability and to have leadership that basically not only serves to support the group's success, but serves to, as the steward of the other four factors, right? That leader has a role in making sure that we've got the right people here, always with the right behaviors. None of these things are static. It's not like you look at any of these factors and you check off the box and that's it, right?
Yeah.
So that leader is making sure we got the right people, that they enjoy psychological safety, that not only is no one compromising it, but we're continuing to elevate it. And the same goes for productivity and the culture of accountability as well.
Do we have the leadership before? Of the right people before, like the eggs or the chicken, which one's better? Or
that's first? That's a great question, you know, but I like to think that when we look at the team, especially when I think about the leader as a part of the team, not apart from
inspiring
it.
And
I know
team.
That, yeah. And not being separate from the team, they are part of it. So when I think about the right people, you have to kind of include the leader in there in that respect. But I think in terms of the specific role of the leader, it's why I call it out separately as an additional factor.
Additional factor, the leader will inspire these people, the right people, to be productive, accountable, true, but they, let's talk about psychological safety. It's a term is used today. How important is it?
It's huge. You know, as you know, in Project Aristotle, Google went into that whole two-year project, if you will, with the belief that having the best people, that the team with the best people was going to be the best team. And what they learned, what that wasn't exactly true necessarily at all. I mean, obviously having great people is really important, but when you have people working really, really well together, they can beat, if you will, a team that may have stronger individual contributors, but don't work together nearly as well. So psychological safety becomes essential in open communication, right? And in having people with the freedom to challenge the process, challenge one another, learn from one another, contribute. And it's, I think essential to kind of unlocking the potential of the right people. Imagine hiring the right people or having the right people in a group where they have all these skills and all these talents, but they're afraid to speak up or speak out or learn or grow because it was going to compromise their currency with everyone else.
So innovation comes out of it.
Yes.
You call it Peernovation. What is
that? I call it Peernovation.
Yeah. Where does it come from? You coined this.
I did. And the idea of its peers, people like me, and innovation, which, you know, I see as creativity realized, right? Creativity operationalized. And it's basically what a group or team of people can do to when they come together and can create something larger than themselves. Simply put, peer advantage plus systems thinking equal peer innovation. And peer advantage, I distinguish from peer influence. Peer influence is this idea of how others can shape our behavior. Peer advantage is what happens when we're more selective, strategic, and structured about the people who we surround ourselves with. And
it's a voluntary process. It's a voluntary process where you actually select these individuals to be in your company
and
or be
intentional.
In their company. It's intentional.
Exactly. Yeah.
Excellent. Where can people find the book?
They can go to Amazon, Barnes & Noble, wherever they can find books. And it's available not only in softcover and hardcover, but in ebook and audiobook as well. I worked with a terrific company out of San Antonio called Game Day Media Enterprises, where we were in their studio and recorded it. And I did not voice the first two audiobooks, and I was excited to be able to do this third one. And I think it was a lot of fun. So thrilled to the audiobook.
Good. That's good. This one was released a few months ago. When was it released exactly?
October of 2020. Yes.
2020. Tell me about Chinese release. So you have one coming up in China.
I do. The book is being released in China, probably another 2 to 3 weeks away. And I'm really looking to that, both for groups and teams, but I'm also creating a certification program where basically people can become certified in delivering Peernovation workshops and programs. And I'm really looking forward to that and looking forward to the idea is I will probably go there in November. We're planning that now in terms of getting that done. It'll be really terrific spending time there and testing it there. It'll be a lot of fun.
Actually, I have a good market there, especially if you make it in the language. Chinese language, because your ideas, they do translate to all cultures, not only our audience here. But that's a good thing to know. Let's talk about the mindset. In your book, as I told you, I read this book, I loved it. In your book, in the 80s, you said, when we talk about collaboration, we were accused of cheating, right?
So what I was talking about, I was kind of making a joke about the fact that when I was in high school or in college, oftentimes we had this rather interesting relationship. We were, you know, you'd be shielding the paper from your neighbor, right? You'd be having this listening to the professor and you'd be taking your notes and you would take your quiz or take your test. There was very little in the way of collaborative learning. And what I joked about was when I was in my master's program and we were set up as a cohort and the whole idea was that we would work together and learn together.
Yes.
I said that back in when I was in high school and college, they would have regarded collaborative learning as cheating. But
makes sense though. Maybe a joke, true. But is it?
But there was something to it.
Yes, the mindset is changing. And I very much advocate this in my classes. Do not think of competition. Competition is an old thinking. You really have to collaborate. I mean, you and I, we talked about this a while back. And when I read it, I said, here you go again. So the mindset has changed, or at least it's changing toward collaboration. How important is collaboration?
I think it's important because when we compete, we tend to think and operate out of scarcity. You know, it's like sales teams who work together. And, you know, this idea of sales teams in most cases is an oxymoron. They just happen to do the same thing, but there's nothing very team about them. They're very much can be very competitive with one another, right?
Sure.
Because they regard it as a finite pie. And what they do is they fight for their slice of it. Sales teams who think in terms of abundance, however, might say, hey, here's a salesperson who's really good at prospecting. Here's another one who's good at closing. Here's someone else who really does a great job of explaining whatever product or service we happen to be selling. What if we all helped one another and figured out how we made the pie bigger? So you're not asking salespeople to help each other out of the goodness of their heart. You're saying the more you help one another and the more you focus on and making the pie larger, the more money everybody's going to make as a result, and the better you're all going to be at your jobs. And it doesn't become a competitive situation. Again, it becomes a whole mindset that's geared to abundance as opposed to scarcity.
Is this your masterpiece, Leo?
It is book number 3. I think, you know, it was an important piece, I think, for me to write, because there are so many people, or only so many people, who will likely participate in a peer group, but a lot of people, and most people who work in any company of any size, are going to be part of a team. And I think these principles that lie in peer groups belong, or at least deserve to be introduced to a larger audience.
Good. Okay. So anything else you want to share with our audience?
You know, I think one of the things that I'm happiest about in many respects when I think about the book and what's emerged over time is the relationship between psychological safety and accountability. Oftentimes people look at psychological safety as just creating an environment that's comfortable where people can talk about everything and they can communicate and all that. But it's also important to recognize that when you create that environment and you consider the purpose of why you are part of a group or a team, that you are always looking to challenge each other to be better. And when you can do that and you can trust the intent of the people, that nobody's calling you out, nobody's trying to, you know, do anything like that. It's just about either making the team better or helping you achieve what you've already expressed you want for yourself, and to know that you have that level of support. I think it creates an entirely different level of accountability. You know, as I know you looked at in the book, there was an article I read from Atlantic Monthly with Pasi Sahlberg, and who's the former director general of the school system in Finland, who talked a bit about the fact that accountability in so many respects is always thought of in a way that they don't even have a direct translation for in the Finnish language. He says, for us, accountability is what you're stuck with when someone's sense of personal responsibility gives way. So the idea isn't that I'm going to hold you accountable. The idea is that you're going to work in an environment where you're going to accept personal responsibility for bringing your A game, because you know that that's what we all do. That's what we owe one another. That's what's going to allow us to be able to really contribute and really hang with everybody in that meeting, because you know everybody's prepared. You know everybody's ready, and you're going to bring your best because of it. So I think particularly when you imagine a CEO group, you know, they're already accountable 6 ways to Sunday with all kinds of stakeholders. What they want when they come to a peer group isn't so much, you know, people that are going to make them play defense. It's people that are going to lift them up and help them achieve, again, what they've already expressed they want
for themselves. Commitment, because I was looking for the commitment part in the book.
Sure.
Commitment is not part of the peer innovation, because you don't have to commit to each other as a CEOs or...
You management. Do. It's part of the accountability piece. So for example, there are two elements of accountability. One of them is follow up and follow through, right? The ability to do what you say you're going to do and make sure that you not only do that, but
this is a commitment.
Or on account of, right. So, and in a way, accountability and commitment become a bit synonymous here, right? But the commitment part of accountability is pretty much in the way you've agreed to show up, right? So when we talked about the right people, what we also, and what we're really talking about here, is that we're going to show up with the right behaviors, the right attitude, the right norms that help us be a really good contributor. And one of those is commitment, which I really talk about in 3 ways. Preparation, that prepared for the meeting. Not only that we're prepared from a standpoint of, you know, having looked at the notes from the last meeting and all that kind of stuff, but prepared in a way where we think to ourselves, all right, if I've got 6 projects, I don't need those things in my head when I go to a group meeting the following day, because I need to be fully present there. So whatever I have to do to kind of clear the decks in my brain so that those things are here so I can focus on the group, that becomes essential. So being present, being there, attendance-wise, obviously is important. So attendance, being present, and preparation are really the three elements of commitment that, you know, I certainly found to be essential, you know, in the groups that I've been working with.
Thank you so much. Thank you for making the time to come and join us. Ladies and gentlemen, the book is Peernovation. The author is Leo Bottary. Leo, thank you for coming.
Hey, well, thank you very much. I appreciate that high compliment from you. So
thank you so much. We'll talk again.
You bet.
Have a good one.
Have a great one. Bye now.